Good morning, children. Today we are going to start our new chapter, that is Brown Wolf. In the live class, we have already discussed the first three paragraphs. So I'll just get into a brief of this. So here, this chapter is name is Brown Wolf, and it is adapted from Brown Wolf itself. That means this chapter which you are reading, it's just a small part. It's just a short passage, some short passages, but the whole collection, that name is Brown Wolf, and this part which you are reading as your chapter, that is adapted from, that is taken from that collection, whose name is Brown Wolf, and it is written by Jack London. Okay, the writer is Jack London. So, let's see how this story starts. They called him Wolf. In build and coat, he was a huge timber wolf. People used to call him Wolf, and the shape and size of his, the body's texture, whatever he had, or the body structure which he had, with that it seemed like he was a wolf. But in his color, he advertised himself as a dog. But within his color, he seemed like a dog. No wolf was ever colored like him. He was brown, deep brown, red brown, a mixture of browns. The color which he had in his body, that was a strange kind of brown. It was a strange kind of brown. There was a mixture of brown. Many browns had been included there. He was brown, deep brown, red brown. Many mixture was there. And his eyes were twin topazes. If you search in Google, then if you search this topaz, then it's a stone, okay, which is of yellow color, golden and brown. So here the first paragraph is totally the description about his physical appearance, the body shape, the color of his body, and the color of his eyes. Walt Irvine and Madge loved the dog very much. Perhaps this was because it had been such a task to win his love. They had really liked this dog. Now, this you might think that who is this Walt Irvine and Madge? So, Walt Irvine and Madge are these two people who were living on that cottage where this dog had come. We'll get to know this. Walt Irvine and Madge loved the dog very much. Perhaps this was because it had been such a task to win his love. Why? When he had arrived at their mountain cottage from nowhere, he had proved to be very unsociable. Now we get the reason that why it was such a great task for them to win his love. Why? Because this dog or wolf, whatever we call, it had come from nowhere. All of a sudden it just appeared and came to their house. And since Walt Irvine and Madge had liked them very much, so they wanted to win his love, but it was not so easy. Why it was not easy? Because he was unsociable. He acted to be unsociable. He behaved unsociably. Now, unsociably means what? Let's talk about what is sociable. If you know what is sociable, then it is when we mix up with people, we mingle, we talk with people. So that is called social nature or sociable. Okay, but when we do the opposite, we don't mix up with people or we just keep ourselves aloof, then that is unsociable. So his behavior of unsociable. He had resented all their advances and had refused to let them touch him. Nevertheless, he had stayed there as he was tired and famished. But when he had recovered, he simply disappeared. Now he had come there because he was very tired, he was hungry. He had no more strength left within him. So he had, maybe he was roaming around the place and not finding any place anymore. So he came there and he started staying there. But once he was, once he had overcome his weakness, once he was now well to do and he got regained back his strength, he left the place. But Walt Irvine and Madge had loved him very much. Now, we might think that this dog or wolf, whatever it is, it has left. So, that means it is the end of him. But that's not so. Why? Let's see. This would have been the end of him if Walt had not spotted him along the railway line and brought him back to the cottage. Suddenly, not suddenly, we can say coincidentally, one day, Walt had spotted the dog somewhere in the railway line, and when he spot him there, when he spotted him there, when he saw him there, he brought him back. And then after that, what he did, Walt, then he brought a metal plate, a plate that was made of metal, and on which was written, "Return to Walt Irvine, Glen Ellen, Sonoma County, California." So this was written on the metal plate. And attached to a collar strapped about the dog's neck, and he tied that plate around the collar, just like a collar, he tied around the neck of the dog. So every time he disappeared, he was caught and returned. So that was a good trick for which Walt had applied. That what he had done, he tied that around his neck, that address. And that was basically the address of Walt Irvine and Midge, where they stayed. So if he would try to run away again and again, so any people who would get him back, they will drop him to the prescribed address. Now, okay, so what I have to tell you is, you will mark these three paragraphs. These are very important, okay? First three paragraphs you will mark. Now, let's see. The remarkable thing about his disappearing. He used to disappear every time. Once he would be brought back, again he will disappear. Again he will be brought back, he will again disappear. But whenever he will run away from the house, one thing was similar. What was that? Every time he fled, he went north. He went towards the north side. Homing instinct was what Walt thought about it. Again, you mark this fourth paragraph. This is also important. The remarkable thing about his disappearing was that every time he went out of the house, he always rushed towards the north side. Okay, he went straight. Not left, not right, nothing. He just went straight, north. And when Walt thought about it, he felt, or he had a thought that maybe the dog's house can be towards the north. That's why, maybe that's a feeling of the dog, that he always moves towards the north. After a futile year of many flights, he decided to remain at the cottage. He did the same activity. He continued this for a year or two. He decided to flee away from the house many times, but he was unsuccessful every time. Why? Because of that metal plate which was tied around his neck. So every time he tried to flee away from the house, he would be brought back. So he kept on trying, but till how much a person will try, right? And he was an animal, so how much more he will try? He can't. So after a futile year, he tried same thing for a futile year. Futile means useless. Okay, he tried, but then that was of no use. He decided to remain at the same cottage. He decided that he will stay in the same cottage. But even after that, a long time went by before Walt and Mate succeeded in getting close to him. Still, if he still stayed there, still it was not possible for them to get close to him. Still, he would not allow anybody come towards him. Not even Madge and Walt also. It was a great victory, for they alone were allowed to touch him. But after a long time, it happened that now they were allowed to touch him. But only they, this Walt Irvine and Mitch, only they would touch him. If anyone else tried, if anybody else apart from Walt and Mitch, if anybody else tried, then they were greeted with an angry growl. So this anybody else, when they would try to get close to this wolf, so what would happen? First he would start growling, and then it would become a snarl. That means these are the various sounds of a dog, and snarling was all the sound he met. People had only heard him snarling, the sound of the dog. That was the only sound which he made. No one had ever heard him bark even once. Nobody had ever watched him or heard him barking. Dogs are supposed to bark because that's the only sound which there's the identifying sound of a dog, right? But he never barked. This is the thing. As Walt and Madge, okay, so you will mark this line in fifth paragraph, starting from if anyone else tried up to bark even once. Okay, you will mark up with this. As Walt and Madge walked along the country road. Now, let's come to this part, that this was the usual routine, or you can say the usual habit of this Walt and Madge and the wolf. Now what happened? One day, now after all this social nature was done, both of them had become close enough. Now let's see what happens. As Walt and Madge walked along the country road one morning with Wolf trailing behind, they heard a crunching of heavy feet. And one morning, while they were just walking through the country road, they heard the sound, and Wolf was behind, just behind them. Okay, they were not walking along with them, but he was behind them. So they heard this, Walt and Madge, they heard the sound, feet stepping. A few minutes later, a man came into view around the turn of the trail. So while they just took, that means from the very far away, it can be seen that the turn of the road, it can be seen. So there, when the man appeared, it could be seen that there was a man. As Walt and Madge walked along the country road one morning with Wolf trailing behind, they heard a crunching of heavy feet. A few minutes later, a man came into view around the turn of the trail. While the man just turned the side of the road, he could be seen. Warm day, Walt greeted him. And while he saw him, Walt greeted that man, that new man. The man paused and nodded. The man also, he paused and nodded. That means he replied back. Okay, that as a way of appreciation, it can be said, or just to greeting, we say, no, if someone of you will greet good morning or something, then we greet back. So that is the thing. The man paused and nodded. I guess I ain't used much to the warm, he said, because Walt had said not good morning or anything such like that, but he had greeted with saying warm day. That means the day is warm, isn't it? So he said that suppose if you say that good morning, and I suppose reply back that what's so good about the morning, I don't feel anything is good about the morning. So that kind of reply was that from his side. I guess I ain't used much to the warm, he said half apologetically. I'm more accustomed to zero weather. But the weather there where he was right now, that was warm weather. But this man, he said that I'm not used to warm weather, but I'm habituated with the cold weather. I like cold weather. You don't find any of that in this country, Walt laughed. And he said that, I'm sorry, but you won't find anything, any of that sort. You will not find any cold weather here. You don't find any of that in this country, Walt laughed. Should say not, the man answered. And I ain't here looking for it either. I'm not looking for warm weather also here, or I'm not looking for any cold weather here. But what is the purpose of my coming here is, I'm trying to find my sister. I have come here for my sister. Why? Maybe you know where she lives. Her name's Johnson. Mrs. William Johnson. Mark this line. Her name's Johnson. Mrs. William Johnson. So when he just said this, "You aren't her Klondike brother," Madge cried, her eyes bright with interest. Her eyes were, "You are her Klondike brother, right?" Just that kind of interest within Madge's eyes. "About whom we have heard so much." That means about the sister, they have already heard quite a lot. "Yes, that's me," he answered. "My name, Miller. Skiff Miller. I just thought I would surprise her." And now we get to know that the name of the person who had just met them on the way, his name was Skiff Miller. Again, you mark this line. The name, the part, paragraph 11 last line and paragraph 13 last sentence. Okay, not last sentence, last line. My name's Miller, Skiff Miller. I just thought I would surprise him. Mark this line. You are on the right track then. Mitch pointed down the hill. Take that little trail turning off to the right. It's the shortcut to her house. You can't miss it. And you are on the and then after knowing that it was the brother of that lady, so she said, Madge said that yes, you are totally on the correct way, and if you just take that way, then you will reach her house, and it's the shortcut. It's the shortcut to her house. You can't miss it. Yes, thank you, ma'am, he said. It was at this juncture. Juncture means the point. It was at this point that Wolf, who had been walking a little away from them, I had told you in the beginning that the wolf was little behind. It was not walking along with them. So, who was a little away from them, nosing through the bushes. That is the activity of the dogs. They always keep on smelling the bushes, no? They always keep on smelling something, whatever they find. Trotted into view. He appeared now in the scene. So, we'll stop here. We'll see up to this part. You read up to this part. Let's see how much of you understand, and then we'll move to the next part. This chapter is little lengthy, but I think we'll finish within two more videos. I think we'll need, or maybe one video. Let's see. We'll do it. We'll complete it. So we'll stop up to paragraph 16. And you watch this video. After watching this video, you read the chapter once again up to this, and then I'll give you some questions on this. Okay, so yeah, here we end it, and the remaining part we'll cover up in the next video. Till then, stay safe and thank you.